Guess this wasn't the best plan. Sorry about that.
Reception and meeting. So it's great to have you here. My name is Fred Kirshner. Oops, you're back. One, two, man. There we go. Okay. I'm on the board for the Wilderness. this is our board here. So, anybody know anybody on that picture? Probably a lot of people are familiar with the faces here. We have 12 members on our board. There are 12 people on our board. It's an all-volunteer board, and we did make a change in officers last fall. It was somebody told me and mentioned that it was a voluntary change. Okay, but we did elect new officers. So I'm the president of the board now. Steve Mueller is the vice president. Tom Atmore is the secretary, and Ned Hancock, who's standing in the back, is the treasurer. And you can see the names of the other board members here. So this is a great board, very dedicated board, and very passionate about what the Wilderness Preserve is all about. We have really four areas that we kind of focus our work around, and we form committees for those four areas. Education, so part of what we do today is education. The talk by Jim Feldman after I'm done. Land management and trails. Invasive species management. And also land acquisition. So those are really the four buckets of primary work that we do, and I'll talk just briefly about all four of those. So let's start with education. So last year, 2016, we had eight evening lectures and six hikes or field programs. This year we have a record nine evening programs and six hikes. And most of those evening programs are held right here in this room at the museum. So we thank the museum for co-sponsoring those with us. Really appreciate the help from the museum on those. And I think they're very popular and well-attended. We started the season this year with the annual bird hike. And is Toria here? Here's Toria. Toria, do you want to come in and just talk about the bird hike this morning?
It's a quick talk. So I can tell you the nitty-gritty is we saw 37 species and 12 species of warblers. Mm-hmm. I've always said I cheat, which is that I count birds in my own yard first. I have to say that, unfortunately, a really high number of those 37 species were in my own yard. Because it was really quiet. It was incredibly noisy and wonderful by the town park. And it was, by my house. And it was really quiet in the town park. And it was very frustrating. So we had fun. I mean, it's always fun to go out with people who love birds. I think next year we're going to do a different location. So that's going to be, and we're going to have to put our thinking caps together about really good places to see what works. That's it.
Okay.
That's one of the many possible. It was a fabulous day everywhere else. It was just really, the song was perfect.
Okay, thank you. Yeah,
thanks
a lot. Thank you. Okay. Moving on, Madeline Island Wilderness Preserve lands and trails. So really the objective of the Wilderness Preserve is to protect and preserve the natural areas on the island for the enjoyment of everyone. So the lands that we have about a little over 2,600 acres on the island. That's all open to anybody in the public, all of you and anyone else who wants to go on it, non-motorized, of course, but there's hiking trails both on the north end and closer to town here. So the black areas really represent where those lands are that we have. And so there's great hiking trails. You can find maps for those trails on our website. You can print them off and take them and go take a hike, and we encourage that. Pardon? Yeah, okay. So we did purchase one parcel of land in 2016, and I think it's this one right here. So you see this little white spot where Wilderness Preserve land is all around it. The owner approached us and was interested in selling it, and so it made sense because it's kind of surrounded by Wilderness Preserve land, and the price was fair. So we did buy that parcel late last year. And then we do have the guided hikes, and we are working on trail development. So we're doing everything we can to try and encourage people to get out and just experience the land. So most of the people, I think, that come to the island, they spend a lot of time around the shore, and it's very beautiful. But if you go in the middle of the island, where our property, our land is, that's really beautiful too, and it's in a different way. And so really do appreciate that land. Just go out there. I think you'll find you'll have a good time. You'll enjoy the time. It was time well spent. If you go on the north end right now, you might want to bring your water boots. That's a little bit wet. On invasives, the aim here, the goal is really to try to control buckthorn and barberry on the island and prevent it from spreading. This is the seventh year that we've been working on this, and it's a big, the scope of this can be very big, bigger than what we as an organization can do, but we're trying to scope it right so that we can be effective and get things done and have sustainable results too longer term. So what we're doing in 2017, we're really going to focus on updating the maps. So we have maps that show where the buckthorn and barberry are on the island, but they haven't been updated for a while. So we're going to update those maps, and then later this year, after we've done that updating, we plan to update our plan of how we're going to attack that based on what we find after we do our maps. I just want to talk again about the website. Kate Bortel is here, and Kate does a great job of managing the website for us. It's a really nice website. If you haven't had a chance to take a look at it, please do. There's all kinds of information about the Wilderness Preserve and the island on here. Great source of information. Like I said, the maps are in there. You can print the maps out. There's some stats here on visits, so we're encouraged that we continue to see an increase in those visits. So we had about 2,700 people that went onto the website, individual, different people, over the last year. 3,200 total visits, so I guess that would mean, Kate, that we had another, I guess 500 people went back and looked again on the site, and then of those 3,200 people, they looked at 5,500 different pages total on there. So that means people were looking at different pages within the website. So just a great source. You can also reach us if you want to get a hold of somebody from the board. That's a good place. You can, of course, you can come and talk to us if you want to, or send us an email. But you can reach us through the website too. 4th of July parade. Almost every year we have a float in the parade, and with the help of Toria, who's just up here, who's been our leader for most of these parade floats, we've done pretty well with the judges too. So last year, 2016, we won the Grand Sweepstakes Award with Milkweed, the Magic Monarch Maker. Does anybody here remember that in the floor, in the parade? And so we really want to encourage you to join us in 2017. So Tori's not going to be here, but as I understand it, they had a great meeting today of the parade committee and have some great ideas. And so this is our 30th year for the Wilderness Preserve. And so just show up. The parade starts at 10:30. Just show up at 10 and be part of the parade, okay? This is just a rundown on our financials for 2016. So we spent $34,000 last year, and you can see the breakdown, the general operations, about $14,700. We spent $1,500 on educational programs, $800 on trail maintenance, $2,000 on invasives, and then we did buy that one parcel of land that was $15,000. Our income was $30,700. Almost all of that is contributions from people like you, so thank you very much. We really appreciate that. We did get also a grant from the Apostle Islands Community Fund that helped us, and we appreciate that too. Our budget this year is $28,000. We don't have any plans right now to purchase any property or any land, but we do plan to spend more in the other areas that I talked about so far, educational programs, trail maintenance, and then invasives. This year. So, oftentimes the board is asked, well, how can I help the wilderness preserve? And so I've listed four things here that I'd ask you to consider. So the first one, which I've already mentioned, is just go out and hike the trails. I think you really get an appreciation for the beauty that we have on these pieces of property. And so get out there. These organized hikes are a great way to do it. Or just print a map and go out and do it yourself. We really value your comments and opinions, so we'd like to hear from you. If you have ideas of things you think we should be doing or things we should be doing differently, please let us know. We also would like your volunteer help. So we do have members that help us. All the work that's done is really board members and other members of the preserve. We're an all-volunteer organization. We have no staff. There's nobody on staff that's paid full-time. So we really count on volunteer work from members. So if any of those committees looked interesting to you, contact us, and you can be part of the committee. And then, if you can renew your membership. So if you're not a member, we ask, please consider joining. If you have been a member and your membership has lapsed, please renew. Or if you're already a member and you'd like to make an extra donation, we'd be happy to take that too. Okay. And then our website is listed there. Again, great source for any of these areas to get more information. So is there any questions or comments that anybody has about what I'm talking about, or any questions anybody wants to ask? Okay. Well, then lastly, I just want to say thank you again to everybody, to our members. We really appreciate your support. So. And with that, I would like to ask Bonnie from the board to come in and introduce Jim.
Our speaker tonight is Dr. Jim Feldman out of the University of Wisconsin, Oshkosh. Although this is his first time speaking on Madeline, he is well known to many of us. His book, published in 2011, has been read by many members of the board of the Wilderness Preserve, as well as the Madeline Island Book Club, featured it last summer. Now, I guess I'm going to bet there's a few members of the book club here tonight. Raise your hands. Look at that. That's so good that you're here. And if any of you are interested in joining that organization, they have a wonderful lineup for the summer. Please talk to those raised hand people, Susie, Robin, Paula.
There's
a sign up in the hallway, too.
At the counter.
At the counter.
And list a book you're reading in the summer, including the two books
you guys are reading. Yeah, very good. So they featured it last summer, had a great read, wonderful discussion. So,
and there were six copies at the library.
And there's six copies at the library. So we know this man, even though it's his first time from Madeline Island speaking. So we all know these Apostle Islands as this solitary place of natural beauty, the sandstone cliffs and the anchorages, the beaches, these dense forests surrounded by clear lakes of pure water. Pristine as it may seem, however, these wild island places are layered with human stories. Dr. Feldman has spent his career as an environmental historian, studying, researching, and telling our story. And I need to tell you tonight how grateful I am that you've written our story. This story in the Apostle Islands is a powerful story of leadership, sacrifice, vision, hardship. And without that, most of us would not be here tonight, actually, the people who had the vision. And I also want to thank you for your tireless work in training our environmental leaders for today and tomorrow. As a professional educator in an environment, thank you. And after three consecutive years trying, I finally want to say welcome to Madeline Island.
To us. What an incredible place. What an incredible day. I hear it's long overdue here. This night reminds me a little bit of a speaking tour I was on a couple of years ago. Do you remember the national park videos, the National Park History series that PBS put out. I was sort of part of a traveling road show that was promoting that. We went around the state and with Wisconsin Public Television. I gave a little talk about the history of the parks. We showed a clip, and most of those were in these sort of dingy, rundown, academic kind of auditoriums. And one of them was at the Red Crown Lodge on a night like this in Minocqua. And that was by far the most successful night because the wine had been flowing. People were laughing at things that weren't even remotely funny. So you have a tall task for you tonight to live up to that. But it seems like off to a great start. It is really cool for me to be here. I think I have never spoken to an overflow audience before. And so if you guys can hear me in the other room, give a whoop or a holler.
They're drinking all the wine.
They're all drinking. So that's due to weather out there. I think it's because you guys, you know, I haven't even get my PowerPoint presentation up yet. You guys know this place. So it's because you all know this place. I'd be so curious to talk to each and every one of you about how you got to the islands. I know some of you grew up here. Others of you came and fell in love with this magical place. So many people I know ended up here sort of on a lark, or they came not expecting to stay, not expecting to buy a place, not expecting to turn their lives upside down, but they ended up here. And so it's really a treat for me and a really gratifying for me to speak to you guys tonight. This is the point of the presentation where I would often say, so who has ever been to the Apostle Islands? It's an interesting task tonight, though, because you all know this place better than I do in many ways, or certainly differently than I do. And usually my task is to try and describe the islands to people that have never been here and might never be here. And tonight, that's not the issue. Tonight, I think the task is on you to think about a place you already know and maybe to think about it a little bit differently than maybe you have before. And also to maybe think about, are there other places that you know of where some of the things that we can see and learn from the island landscapes can be seen and learned elsewhere as well. As you know, it's a pretty spectacular place. When I describe it to other people, I describe it as this archipelago of islands. Each island is unique. Each island has its own history, some patches of old growth, some islands with deer, some without. Every island with its own story. It's really a magical place. And I usually show them a bunch of photographs to try and capture this. And I often use this as a starting point for my talks. And this was, and I'm sure you guys will remember this, in 2005, National Geographic Magazine pulled together a group of experts to rate the American national parks. And you know what was the number one most appealing park in the whole United States? Lost Isles National Lake Park. Other parks, Yosemite, Grand Canyon, Yellowstone, spectacular, of course. You can say that this doesn't compare with Yosemite or Yellowstone. My son Sam is here. We were actually in Yellowstone last summer, and we got to share Old Faithful with 5,000 other people. It was amazing, and it was beautiful, and it was not the solitary beauty and the quiet reflection that you can get here. And so what National Geographic said was, it's the most appealing park. And that had to do with its solitude, its relatively low level of visitation, its ecological health. They said, these are some quotes from that report, in good shape ecologically, not over-visited. No man-made lights are visible. The islands are in a natural, pristine condition. The aesthetic appeal of the land and water interaction is both dramatic and comforting. And we all know this. They captured a place that we all love. In 2004, this area, parts of Apostle Islands National Lakeshore were designated the Gaylord Nelson Apostle Islands Wilderness. I'll come back to this in a little bit. It's the single highest form of environmental protection that we can give in the United States. And I'll come back to that in a little bit. And again, you know, I often tell people about the charming towns of La Pointe and Bayfield and how this is these are the gateway to the Apostle Islands. And people come here, though, they come maybe for Bayfield, they come really for the islands, for the rustic charm and to explore these gorgeous places. But what people often don't see, And certainly what they don't expect to see is evidence of the island's rich and deep human history that's still visible today. I mean, we're speaking in the Madeline Island Museum, so it's a little bit absurd for me to say this here, that you don't expect to see evidence of the island's past in this particular place. But as you all know, this has been a long settled place, a long humanized place. For Native Americans centuries ago, for French fur traders in the 1600s, for fishermen, for farmers, for loggers, all of these people, over generations, they made homes and workplaces in the islands. And their stories, their actions, remain embedded in this place that seems today to be so pristine, to be such a wilderness. I'm perpetually behind on my PowerPoints. This is just a problem I have as a teacher. So this was supposed to represent all island history. Bonnie mentioned that I've written this book, and I'm not going to talk about the whole book today. I'm going to tell three stories from the islands today and offer some thoughts about what each of these three stories mean. But I'll tell you first what sort of my central point is going to be. And it is that we need places like the Apostle Islands. We need places like this because we have so many examples of places where industrial activity of logging and mining has degraded nature, has ruined nature, has destroyed pristine nature. But the Apostles can be a place, an example where human choices led to a different outcome. They led to regeneration, a place where we can learn about the consequences of human actions for better and for worse. The Apostle Islands can be a place for us to think in new ways about the human place in nature. And this humble little place that many of you call home is just a terrific spot and opportunity to think really deep and interesting thoughts about human relationships with nature. And so today I'd like to demonstrate what I mean about the return of wilderness to a place with a human history by talking about three stories.
Okay.
And those three stories, the three examples I'd like to give tonight are the first, a failed attempt to create a park here in the Apostle Islands in the 1930s. The second story will be about the logging of Outer Island, and the third will be about the fishing and farming community on Sand Island. And so the first story that I'd like to tell starts here. This actually isn't the Apostle Island. This is meant to represent the cutover. All of northern Wisconsin, we call it the Northwoods today, but it used to be called the cutover, because this is what it looked like. And in the 1920s, the logging mills were shutting down, the trees were running out, and the tourism industry was pretty strong even then, and local businessmen, local entrepreneurs got together and they said, you know, we need something to replace logging as one of the core parts of the economy in the Chequamegon Bay. We've had tourists coming to the island since the 1850s to see the lighthouses, to go fishing, to go camping, and so you know what we should do? We should have a national park. So they wrote to their congressman, worked with the National Park Service, to send out an investigator, a representative of the National Park Service, a guy named Harlan Kelsey. And he came out to investigate whether Apostle Island should be declared a national park. And he came and the local boosters gave him a gala welcome. They threw a big party. They had dinners for him. They had him fly in an airplane over the islands. They took him on a tour on some of the private yachts of some of the wealthiest local people. They brought him out to the logging camp on Outer Island to see what it was like out there. I should add, the people who brought him out had never actually been to a national park before. And so they didn't really know what Harlan Kelsey was looking for, and he came, and they took him on a tour of a logging camp, and Harlan Kelsey was not impressed. This is what he said. He said, what must once have been a far more striking and characteristic landscape of dark, coniferous, original forest growth has been obliterated by the axe followed by fire. The virgin forest has been ruthlessly exterminated. The ecological conditions have been so violently disturbed that probably never could they be more than remotely reproduced. This project does not meet national service standards. So this was a blow for the people around here. It certainly seems surprising from the vantage point of today. right? Today we are a wilderness area. We have the highest form of environmental protection that can be given. The Wilderness Act was passed in 1964, and this is the definition of wilderness according to the Wilderness Act. It's a place where the earth and its community of life are untrampled by man, where man himself is a visitor who does not remain. And yet, somehow, the Apostle Islands, despite what Harlan Kelsey saw in 1929, they qualify as a wilderness area. So what changed that between 1930 and 1970 when the park was created, or 2004 when the wilderness was designated? I'm going to go over this part really quickly. We can come back to it. But certainly the circumstances, social context, was very different in 1970. Environmentalism was all the rage. The first Earth Day, Rachel Carson, Silent Spring had been a few years before. People cared about nature, pristine wild nature, in a way they didn't really care in 1930. Outdoor recreation was popular in a way in the 1970s that it was not in the 1930s. And that has to do with changing economics and the post-war economic boom and all sorts of things like that. But so the social context is different. So that's one thing that had changed. Another was political leadership. Many of you will remember Gaylord Nelson, of course, the Apostle Islands named after him, the founder of Earth Day, one of the chief promoters and architects of the wilderness movement itself. He first introduced Apostle Islands National Lakeshore in 1965. As governor, I was just talking with some people about this earlier. As governor, he was the one who said, you know, we can revitalize the economy of northern Wisconsin by connecting this place as a recreational, as a spot of recreation, and that will bring people from Minneapolis and Chicago and Milwaukee and Madison and Omaha, and in fact, it did. And so his leadership is really a big part of creating Apostle Islands National Lakeshore. And then, of course, the other thing that changed is that the trees had grown back, right? The landscape had changed. The ruined landscape that Harlan Kelsey had visited in the 1930s, in 1929, 1930, was gone. Birch trees, old forests, regrowing over those scars, so that people didn't see those scars anymore. So why is this story of the first park significant? Well, I guess a couple of things. Part of the most important part of it is what this tells us about the ability of nature to come back, of the ability of wild nature to return into places once humans have sort of left them alone. What makes the islands so significant is they're a terrific example of the way the islands, the nature can regenerate. But also a way of thinking about how places have become wild again. And the term that I use in the book to describe this is how the islands have gone through a process called rewilding, the return of wild characteristics to a place that was once humanized. But it would be a mistake to think about this as just a process of nature, as just a process of ecology, of just, well, the trees came back. That is not the lesson here. The lesson is not that trees just happened to come back, but that the rewilding of the Apostle Islands has been both a natural process and a historical one. But we often talk about the nature-culture divide. This is a process, rewilding recognizes the role of both nature and of history or of culture in bringing wild characteristics back to a place that was once humanized. And so to talk about that, I want to move to these other two stories. And we'll start with Outer Island. Maybe this time I can say, who's been to Outer Island? So, you would never get that response in. So hard to get to, remote, unless I guess you live here and have a big boat. It's a pretty interesting place. This is a vegetation map of Outer Island. And each of those many, many different color-coded cross-hatched squares shows you a different kind of environment, different forest composition on Outer Island, and that's a big confusing map, and I don't want to spend too much time on that. I want to break it down into these three parts. There are three significant parts of Outer Island. The bottom line there that kind of divides the island in half, the significant differences there is that south of the island, of that line, there are almost no hemlock trees, and north of that line there are hemlock trees. And then the uppermost tip is old growth forests. One of the last best examples in the Western Great Lakes of an old growth forest. So how does this forest come to be divided so starkly? Well, it has to do with logging, as you might expect. All of these pictures are actually from Harlan Kelsey's 1929 report. I was extremely, historians are really big dorks, you probably know that. And I was in the National Archives in Washington, and I was doing research on this, and I came across Harlan Kelsey's report, and I had read the report before, but I in the original were all the pictures, and they didn't have those in the Park Service headquarters here, so I was able to get copies of them made and sent over to the courthouse over in Mayfield. And so all these pictures are Harlan Kelsey. You can imagine him taking pictures, thinking, "Hey, a bunch of morons." But so the logging in Outer Island starts pretty late. If that was a good enough line, we'll hear it in another room. So logging there starts in the 1920s, pretty late, relatively considered, because it's so far away. Pretty big logging operation, camps of as many as 250 men working through the winter. One of only a few islands that they actually thought it was worthwhile to bring a railroad out there. As many of you guys probably know that part of the story. Did we hear that?
Yeah, okay. So those strong.
Here's a picture of the main logging camp there in 1930. So logging's trucking along in late 1929, something really bad happens. Great Depression. Yep. Great Depression basically swallows the Schrader Lumber Company. It completely shuts down. Logging stops. They made it about halfway up the island. This is actually my favorite photograph from that Kelsey report, because this is what Harlan Kelsey wrote on the side. He says, "I'm at the railroad in the primeval forest, ready for next year's operations in Outer Island. In less stop, 6 years, we'll see the entire destruction of this marvelous woodland." So again, put yourself in his mind. He's standing behind him. Is all this devastation, like that picture that I showed you, and then he's looking up the railroad track into the primeval forest, and then of course the Depression comes, the company stop closes, and that's where the logging stops. So south of the island is logged, north of the island is not. Later on there's some selective logging in the northern part of the island. The southern part of the island, something else happens. What happens in northern Wisconsin in the Northwoods after logging? Fire. Peshtigo, Cloquet, you know, all these places where this happened. And so 1936, after a couple years of all that logging slash, drying out the wind and the rain, wind and the sun, the southern part of the island catches fire. So this is an aerial photograph from 1938. And you can see what a stark line that is. Just to show you, I wanted to see if you can track this line. You see, that's the railroad bed that shows you how far north they have gotten. And then, by the time they create the park, 1978, the forest has grown back, right? Just like we said, the forest has grown back. And here's that railroad grade. I don't know if you can just make out the line going north-south, but the angle of the picture is a little bit different. But so this brings us back to that vegetation map. The reason the forest looks the way that it does is this history of logging and fire, or I should say, logging and not logging, and the Great Depression, and the decision by the Schrader Lumber Company to shut down. So, south of this line, where the fire burned, hemlocks, which had once been a forest dominant, don't grow back. The fires burned all the hemlock seeds that would have been there, and so as that forest regrew, some of you have been there, it's very thick, but it doesn't have hemlock trees. North of the line, where there's only selective logging and they never had a fire, you still have hemlock trees. So that part of this map is described by human history. It's not so simple as to say the trees grew back. The trees grew back in ways profoundly shaped by history. Of course, if you go there today, you can see some of this stuff. I have actually never been to the interior of Outer Island to see some of the rusting machinery and things left behind by the Schrader Company or by the outfits in the northern part of the forest. And so one of the ways to tell this story is to tell a story of recovery, to tell a story of a place that was once devastated growing back, wilderness returning. And that is certainly a part of the story. The word recovery implies that the land was injured and is now returning to health. And in this case, the Schrader Company is a pretty easy villain, right? A big bad logging company that devastated, clear cut it, left it to burn, disappeared, didn't take care of the land. So that's a pretty easy story to tell. We're going to complicate that story a little bit when we get to Sand Island. But even on Outer Island, it's not so simple. Because there's that other part of the northern part of Outer Island we haven't talked about yet. And that's an old growth forest. And the reason it's an old growth forest is because of the lighthouse. And many of you guys know this. That at each of the lighthouses and the apostles, the federal government, the lighthouse service, retain a patch of land around the lighthouse for the use of the lighthouse keepers and their families. Now, I honestly have no idea how much wood it takes to keep this place warm out on Outer Island through mid-December. It's certainly a lot, but it was not enough to log the Outer Island forest. So if you look at a plat map, and you can see where the lighthouse reserve is blocked out in red there, and then you can see how that maps on to the old growth forest and the vegetation map that I showed you earlier. So you look at a modern map of Outer Island's forest, and it is the way it is because of human choices, because of human history. Again, easy villain. Not so many villains on Sand Island. I'm not going to ask how many of you have been to Sand Island. Many of you, this is going to be familiar with. I actually haven't been to the museum here in a really long time. There are some Sand Island things in the museum here, aren't there? Yeah, you would know for sure. What Sand Island things are here?
Oh my gosh. You know what, honestly, I don't know. Well, I just know that we do.
We have Sand Island.
You put me on the spot.
Sorry, didn't mean to put you on the spot. So Sand Island has a pretty long history as well. There's some archaeological evidence that shows it was used as maybe an itinerant fishing camp or a hunting camp by Native Americans, maybe by fishermen. The sort of European American history starts there in the 1870s or so when a man named Frank Shaw acquires land on Sand Island and becomes the first full-time year-round resident of Sand Island. He's a fisherman. He's also a farmer. He planted strawberries. He was particularly well known for strawberries. It's still a tradition around here, of course. Potatoes, hay, a few other market crops. And so his land was on the very southeastern corner of Sand Island. And this is Frank Shaw's daughter, Anna May, and her husband, Bert Hill. He moved to the island full-time in 1910. He fished for a little while. He realized it was a lot of work. He hung it up, and he just concentrated on farming. He expanded the farming operations, the apple orchards. Well, we'll come back to some of that, to Bert Hill and his farm site in a little while. As you guys know, starting in about 1890, an immigrant community, mostly Norwegian, settles on Sand Island. So by 1910, there's sort of a nice little settlement there, as you can see from this map. Residents of the island created a post office in 1911. It was called the Township of Shaw. They built the road, the north-south road there, in 1914. The schoolhouse opened in 1910 with a student body of 13. What's the student body on Madeline?
13.
At its height, the Sand Island Schoolhouse had 24. By 1918, there was a cooperative store. There was even a short-lived underwater telephone cable to the mainland. Fishing was at the center of the Sand Island life and the Sand Island community. Most of the immigrant settlers had been fishermen in Norway, and they continued that tradition here. They fished for lake trout and whitefish and herring. There was farming as well. Some of the families were only farmers. One of the things I talk about a lot in the book is the way that all these different, we sometimes think of the fishing economy and the logging economy and the farming economy. They were all overlapped. The fishermen fished, but in the winter they worked in the logging camps. And the farmers grew produce, and they sold it at the logging camps, or they sold it to the tourist resorts that were popping up in the area. So there's tourism, and there's logging as well. And the Sand Island community persisted until 1944, was the year the Norings left Sand Island, the last year-round family to leave Sand Island. There's all sorts of reasons for that. Partly it was young people that were growing up there didn't want to stay on Sand Island. They wanted more excitement. They wanted more opportunity. Part of it was, of course, it was just hard to make it work economically, to be so far away, to be so peripheral. Farming was pretty untenable. So by 1944, there's no longer a year-round community on Sand Island. And so that means that the Sand Island undergoes this process that we're calling rewilding, that the wilderness starts to come back. These landscapes that were humanized as farm fields or lumber camps or fishing villages start to get taken back over by wild nature. This place that had once been a home becomes wild again. Some of the buildings, this is actually the Moe Farm, and you'd be walking through this if you park at the dock and then walk up to the lighthouse. And if you didn't know that it was an old farm field, it just looks like a pretty open clearing in the woods with a bunch of wildflowers. But because we know so much about Sand Island, we have diaries and journals and interviews with many people who grew up there, we can actually be really precise in connecting the ways that wilderness has come back, or wildness has come back to Sand Island, in ways that are really powerfully informed by very specific individual choices. So let me give you a couple of examples of that. Remember I said when Bird Hill gives up his fishing business, he concentrates on farming and he expands his apple orchards. And so he planted apples along East Bay Road and one of the fields that was down there. Today, those apple trees are some of the oldest trees on that southeastern tip of Sand Island. And in some places, the forest has grown up around the apple trees. So if you think about apple trees growing in a forest, that's a pretty powerful metaphor for wild nature coming back into a place that was once humanized. And a way of thinking about the human presence in rewilding landscapes. Another place you can see that is, again, I'm a little bit behind. I've actually been pretty good so far. Another way you can see that is, again, the way that the fields, as maintenance of the field stops, the fields start filling in, getting grown in, woody vegetation starts filling in. One of the things that's really interesting about Sand Island is that in 1982, when the Park Service did its first sort of vegetation survey of this area, what they found was that the woody vegetation was encroaching on the old fields in perfectly straight, geometrically straight lines. And that the sort of first settler or colonizing vegetation were going in following the drainage ditches that Bird Hill had dug when he was trying to expand his agricultural operation. So again, the way it's happening, very much on the ground, is happening because of the choices made by Bert and Anna May Hill. By the choices made, in other words, what we describe as history. This same story is repeated all over Sand Island, right? So this is the schoolhouse today. The site of the Noren Farm, they're the last farm family to leave in 1944. It's a particularly rich place to see this happening. If you know what to look for, you can find the old farm equipment, you can find the well, you can find the chimney, you can find the cornerstone. Those are all going to be gone very soon. But you know what's still going to be there? A lilacs that Birgit Noren planted. They dug up spruce trees on parts of their farm and planted them to form a windbreak to protect them from Lake Superior. Those trees are still there. Right? Those trees aren't going away in the way that this is going away. So what's the significance of the Sand Island story? Well, for one, the rise and fall, the rewilding of Sand Island, it's an example of the closely tied human and natural history in places like the Apostle Islands. Sand Island is one of the perfect places to think about this because you see evidence of these connections between human choices and wild nature all over the place. That's just because the Palms are one of the family that live there. But it's rich in meaning. Here you see the Noren Farm clearing from the sky. How many of you guys have done an airplane overflight? All right, I'm getting closer, but if you haven't, it's really a spectacular way to see this place. So here's where it starts to get really interesting. Because now the Park Service is responsible for managing these places. And so it turns out it's actually really hard to manage a rewilding landscape and to try and bring the meanings out of the landscape that we've been talking about tonight. And part of that has to do with just Park Service policy. When the park takes over a place, they have a set of policies that they use that are sort of created at the bird's eye level, and they're not able to respond to on-the-ground conditions that are different in every park or in every island or in every plot of land as we know them to be. And so when the Park Service came in 1970 and the islands were valued for their seemingly pristine natural condition, the Park Service started managing most of the park as a wilderness to protect and preserve its wilderness characteristics, which is why people wanted it protected. And so what that meant is they applied service-wide policies to the management of Sand Island and other places like it. And so one of those management policies, these are two kind of boring quotes, but I'm going to read them anyway. They said that where such uses have impaired wilderness qualities, management will be directed towards the restoration of wilderness character. So the Park Service looks at this and says, well, we need to make it look like a wilderness. This makes it pretty clear humans used to live here. So let's take it out. Later on, they have a much more bureaucratic term that is actually kind of almost funny in its bureaucracy. They call this non-conforming conditions. Whenever you find non-conforming conditions, you need to take them out. And so what the Park Service starts to do is to remove visible signs of human activity. They remove fishermen's cabins, they remove logging camps, other remnants of that extractive economy. And so what this does is it makes wilderness, it makes the islands look more pristine, right? It takes out this evidence of history. And I understand why that happens. These actions followed the emerging Park Service goal of restoring wilderness characteristics to places that are marked by human use. And their intent is to make the islands seem more wild by erasing evidence of resource extraction of the past. But taking away the logging cabin doesn't change the fact that it was logged, right? You don't change the history, you just change the way it seems today. And so these policies, combined with the power of wild nature to grow back, they obscure some of the stories that are so interesting about the apostles. They've created these wild and healthy environments that are so important in the apostles today. And I want to stress, I'm not suggesting that the islands are somehow not good because they're so wild. They are incredibly important because they're so wild and healthy. But these policies run the risk of obscuring some of the most important stories that the islands have to tell us. Removing these non-conforming conditions and other evidence of human history obscures the role of human choices in creating today's wild landscapes. And that's the story the Apostle Islands have to tell us. They can tell us about the long-term legacy of human choices in nature and the consequences of human actions. And this is one of the things that ecologists are starting to recognize more and more. There's a plot of land in western Massachusetts called the Harvard Forest, where they have studied land use going back to 1600. And they have learned that sometimes even one turn of the plow changes the forest composition of a plot for hundreds of years. If you look at the forest composition of the Yucatan Peninsula in Mexico today, you can still see today where Mayan Indians had their farm plots in the year 1200. Because the choices that we make have profound implications for the future of the places that we care about. All human choices, from the industrial logging of Outer Island to the creation of lighthouse reserves, the decision to plant lilacs and spruce trees, these have long-term consequences. And these choices are going to be evident in the island environments for decades to come. And these are not, the evidence of human history does not have to be a tarnish on the places that we care about. Just because it has a human history doesn't mean it's not valuable. It doesn't mean that it's not wild. And other places teach this lesson too. How many of you guys have been to Point Reyes National Lakeshore, National Seashore? Oh, man, you guys are hard to beat. This is a place that has a very similar history to the Apostle Islands. But so do even the places we call wilderness. My first stint with the Park Service, I was a ranger out on Raspberry Island in the 1990s. But before that, I was a park ranger at the Grand Canyon. And if you hike down one of what's called the Hance Trail, the Horseshoe Mesa, in the middle of the wilderness of the Grand Canyon, you find the ruins of an old copper mine. And this is a story that we see over and over again in Olympic National Park, in the Adirondacks, in Shenandoah National Park. These are all places that have been humanized, that are wild again, and we need to think differently about why those places are valuable. These places give us a chance to have different kinds of conversations about wilderness. Wilderness debates in this country have often been about the West, right? Yosemite, Yellowstone, Frank Church, River of No Return Wilderness, that's an awesome title, name of a wilderness area, Desolation Wilderness. These are places where it seems like modern industrial society is the bad guy, the encroaching villain. Very different story here in the Apostle Islands, right? This is not a place of encroaching industrial damage. Nature is on the offensive here, right? It's human history that's receding somehow. And so the point is that these places give us a chance to really rethink the human relationship with nature. And I'm not saying cut down anything you want because it's all going to grow back. That is not the lesson here. The lesson here is be really careful with what you do because every choice you make matters. Every choice that you make about how we care, or we make, about how we care for our land is going to be written into the landscape for a very, very long time to come. These places, they deserve our protection. These places deserve our love. And this management should be an active one. The Park Service has such a difficult task. They have surging deer populations. They have a warming climate. They have to find ways to respond to these problems. But we need to recognize these problems have roots in human history too. And pretending that nature and history are separate categories doesn't let us tell the full story. Sometimes this might mean monitoring and removing exotic species that threaten island environments, but sometimes it might mean leaving Birgit Noring's lilac bushes where they are so that we can go there and learn these lessons about the long-term impact of human choices. And recognizing these stories, it doesn't compromise the value of the Grand Canyon to know that there was logging there or there was mining there. It doesn't compromise the value of the Apostle Islands to know that there was fishing and farming and logging here. These are wild places. These are wilderness places. These places tell us stories about past human choices and their consequences. Yes, these are stories about destruction caused by logging and mining. They're also stories about making a home. They're stories about making choices that led to the regeneration of wild places. The choices of fishermen and lumberjacks and land managers of a century ago are imprinted on island landscapes, and they're going to remain so deep into the future. As we come to recognize the long-term consequences of these actions, we can better predict the legacies of our own choices, and we can better protect the wild places like the Apostle Islands that we all love. Thank you guys very much.
Well, there's a family that's still trying to hold on to their property on Sand Island, A, and B, how soon do you expect that Madeline Island would be cleared of summer visitors?
you really just went straight for the hardest question there. I was a guest of Mary Rice's, her Sand Island place for a couple of days. And you guys might know this, but might not know this, but you were in the presence tonight of Wisconsin royalty. My great-great-great-grandfather was the founder of the all-important town of Slinger, which most of you have never heard of, of course. Has anyone ever been to Slinger? Look at this. So we have a property in my family that's been in my family since 1875 or something like that, which is pretty rare in Wisconsin, right? Not unheard of. If the federal government came and told me, by the way, buddy, this Cedar Lake is national treasure, you're all kicked out, I'd be pretty pissed off. That family has been trying, and several others have been trying since 1970 to try and come up with a way to... it depends on who you ask, it's a very controversial question, but kind of come up with a way to maintain their long-term tenure on those places. Some of you probably know this, that when the park was created, the federal government gave the families that were landowners in the place that's today the park, the option to sell right at that time, to take a 25-year lease, or to take a lifetime lease. And depending on what you took, determined how much money you got paid. The Sand Island families, most of them took lifetime leases in the name of people that were 1 or 2 years old in 1970. So that gives you a sense of how long that inholding will be the case. And they're trying, every way they can, and I can't blame them, to try and figure out a way to be able to stay there longer. I don't know if they'll be successful in that. I don't know if they should be successful in that. I'm not sure you've had enough wine to answer that question. it's a painful story for them, for sure. And I tried to be super, really attentive to that as I wrote the book. And I work with the Park Service too. I understand both sides.
So was it Kelsey? Was that his name? Who wrote it? So, it's fascinating to me that he spent so much time basically to document that the islands had been logged.
Yeah.
But I'm wondering if did he see any promise, in the area, and was his report used in any way when we came back 30 years later and reconsidered and had a different decision?
The answer is, the second part is easy. No, I don't think that they really considered his report at all in 1970. Things were just so different. He recommended that the area would be better as a state park. So what he suggested was that it should become a state park. And sort of the politics of outdoor recreation is something I do talk about in the book. Maybe more interesting is that on that same tour, Kelsey also went to Isle Royale and decided that should be a park. So in a sense, it was that was the part of that trip that became a national park. And incidentally, and this is really interesting, and I haven't actually gotten to the bottom of this, he was also really central in the creation of Shenandoah National Park, which, as some of you guys will know, was a humanized place, a landscape of farms and fields that were removed to create a wilderness-like place, much like here, but starting in 1930. So why he decided it could happen there and not here, maybe that was just East Coast chauvinism, that part I don't know, but yeah.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but my understanding of Outer Island was that there was logging that went on beyond 1930 in the northern part of the island, the Lullaby Lumber Company.
Absolutely.
That wasn't as invasive. Is that correct?
That is correct. It was much more selective logging. So it wasn't the clear cutting that happened south of that line. Much more selective logging, as in picking the specific things they wanted. And the really significant thing is that it didn't lead to a forest fire, because enough of the forest canopy was still there to prevent the sort of drying conditions that happened in the south.
And my understanding is some of the ruins from that camp are still there.
Correct. Okay. Yep. Yep. Mm-hmm.
About 75 years ago, I spent a week on Outer Island at an old lumber camp.
Uh-huh.
And my understanding was it was the Lullaby Furniture logging camp. Was that
insane? Juvenile furniture in Ashland.
What?
It was a juvenile furniture company in Ashland.
Crimson and Stephen Blank.
Rocky chairs and stuff.
And was that the same as the Schrader?
No. So that's what he was referring to earlier. The Schrader Company, basically, they, as far as I know, that's also the town of Schrader on the North Shore. That's the same company. That was a company town. So it's a very different company. Schrader went away after 1930. The Lullaby Lumber Company was its own thing in the northern part of the island in the 50s.
Schrader also logged Michigan Island.
Yep, and Stockton. Yep.
Probably endorse your view of preserving human history in the parks, in this park particularly. Are there policy changes that have to happen to make that happen?
So the question was, are there policy changes that have to happen to make the idea of protecting human stories in the wilderness, essentially? As I was working on this project, was exactly the time that the park was going through what they called at the time the wilderness suitability study. There was controversy, as you know, almost everything about the Paso Islands National Lakeshore has been controversial one time or another. And the question of what island should be designated as wilderness was one of the issues that came up. And part of the question was whether Basswood and Sand Island should be inside the wilderness or outside the wilderness. If they were inside the wilderness, the Park Service interpretation was we would not be able to manage it for this story of rewilding, that we would be required to remove these non-conforming conditions.
And
what'd you say?
Not quarries.
Well, that's the quarries are pretty interesting, right?
Yeah.
We're not going to remove those.
Yeah.
They're a pretty powerful place to think about this kind of stuff. But so the result of that, although a lot of people really didn't like the idea that less acreage was going to be given this ultimate protection of wilderness, the decision was made to leave Sand and Basswood out of the wilderness area. And so that was controversial in a number of circles at the time. That was the way that the Park Service decided to make that happen. Yeah.
What about some of the archaeological, like pre-Columbian artifacts that are falling into the lake at the moment, and the National Lake or Lecture inability to admit that, or to let archaeologists go there. What is the explanation?
I don't have anything for you on that one, I'm afraid. I'm not too familiar with that story, so I'm sorry, I don't know the answer to that one. Yep.
Well, going forward, what's the bottom line with the management of the Apostle Islands National Lakeshore? I know the local director, been there many years, kind of favors wilderness, I think.
Yeah,
rewilding, which is a joke. But the political question is, where do you think they stand now on saving these cultural resources?
I thought the first question was the hardest one.
The Bear Island cabin, they took the roof off and they let it fall in, so forth.
My experience, and I'm only speaking from my experience here, is that the park administration hasn't always been very willing to be creative in thinking about how they might manage cultural resources in the areas designated as wilderness. There is certainly potential on Basswood and Sand Island to develop really interesting interpretive stories or interpretive exhibits, trails that tell this story of rewilding. And to some extent, that's why those islands were left outside of the designated wilderness area. I think that means that all of the cabins on Rocky and South Wind and the other places you're talking about will either just be sort of not addressed at all, or in some cases removed.
Boom.
You know, this is the way that the Park Service.
Aren't they set? As a federal agency, aren't they subject to Section 106 of the Historic Preservation Act? Anything over 50 years old has to be considered for preservation.
That has to do, some places, yes. And you know, I think it's fair to say that not everything needs to be preserved. There are certainly places in the Apostle Islands that we could say this particular spot isn't adding to this experience and perhaps can be revegetated in a way that helps the ecological health of the area. But my understanding is that places have to have a particular designation before that.
As a private developer, you have to go through a whole process to look at that and say, does that have historical significance or not? And I would assume a federal agency has to have the same requirements as a private developer does.
I think they do, and I think they would look at those and say, and that these areas that we want to remove don't have that significance. Mm-hmm. And it, you know, try telling that to a Rocky Island, the descendant of a Rocky Island fisherman. So, yeah.
Talk about the issues of forest management, just at large, like in like extremely huge western parks, but then how would that forest management affect areas such as the Apostle Islands? What would be the modern, I guess I'm not sure how to ask the question, but there seems to be arguments about logging or how to log, and there seems to be a lot of disease and forest problems that lead to relatively large fires, et cetera.
I'm not exactly sure. The issues are so different that in some ways they're not the same.
Okay.
You know, the some of what you might be referring to is, you know, some parts of the Pacific Northwest are these old growth forests with the spotted owl, which is the big controversy of 20, 30 years ago or so, remains controversial today, because those are pretty special, pristine forests. I mean, they're not, nothing's pristine, but there are also places that have entire towns, entire economies, based solely on logging of those places. And so it's just one of these almost unsolvable, unreconcilable problems. Here, where almost all the forests in Wisconsin are second or third growth, issues have much more to do with managing invasive species or figuring out which areas you want to manage for certain kinds of uses, for recreational uses or for wildlife habitat, in ways that are just really different because they're not old growth forests.
Okay. Can you comment on wildlife, and animal populations, the species that may have formerly populated an island and no longer do? Is there any kind of an effort being made to introduce animals to certain areas or whatever?
There's very little. The question was, can I comment on sort of wildlife management in on the island? You know, one of the really interesting things about the islands is that some have deer and some don't. And when you go to an island or a place that doesn't have deer, the understory is so different. On Raspberry Island, you could almost walk across the middle of the island without ever touching the ground, because the understory was so dense with Canada yew, which is one of the first things that deer eat on the mainland, so it doesn't grow anywhere. So one of the things that's really interesting about the islands is the way that each of them has its own sort of different history of wildlife. I know there's been some wolf activity on some of the islands, but mostly periodically. There was in the 50s or 60s an effort to reintroduce pine martens on Stockton. I don't think that ever went anywhere. As far as I know, there's not any other kind of reintroduction efforts in that way. Although there's some ways that islands are really valuable for that kind of thing because they have such incredible natural borders.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Any other questions? Yeah.
The pine marten has showed up on Stockton Island.
Has it?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. On its own, though, this time, probably. But I guess they don't know.
They don't know.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. They're going to be studying it more thoroughly right mm-hmm. now.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You were saying earlier that
squirrels.
If the government came and took your land, basically, mm-hmm. that you'd be pretty pissed, and
mm-hmm.
that people are still trying
to
preserve their property in the islands. But of course, there was so many people here who that happened to,
mm-hmm.
Native peoples.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just curious if, in your studies, you found any interesting. Anything you could see in the
mm-hmm.
ecology of the islands that showed evidence of their habitation and land use?
So the answer to that is yes and no. We environmental historians and paleoecologists and archaeologists are learning that Native American presence profoundly shaped landscapes really everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
And that was certainly the case here.
Mm-hmm.
It's really hard to reconstruct at the level that I was trying to, what pre-contact use might have been like here,
mm-hmm.
because the earliest sort of documents that we have to do that are the records of a government agency called the Government Land Office that sent out surveyors to sort of plot and map the land and took notes on what the environment was like in each place, and that's what sort of paleoecologists use to reconstruct
mm-hmm.
past environments. But that was long after contact. And even then, by the time, you know, by 1600, the Native American population here had already changed because of the pressures of Europeans pushing westward.
Mm-hmm.
Europeans went west, that pushed Iroquois west, that pushed Ojibwe west, that pushed the Sioux west. So it'd be really hard to reconstruct that. And the other way I would answer this is, because of my interest in this question of humanized landscapes, I wanted to start my story it was once devastated, it was once, you know, so not with it was once pristine, and when Native Americans lived here, which I don't think was the case anyway, if that makes sense. I do talk about Native American inhabitants in these regions quite a bit in the book, because there's other parts of the story I haven't talked about today that had to do, well, in two places in particular. One was the fishing economy. The growth of the fishing economy required basically the suppression of Native American fishing here. And especially that was true for the growth of the sort of tourist fishing economy of the 20th century. So that's a sort of part and parcel with the treaty rights controversies. And the story of the park itself is really tied to Bad River and Red Cliff. Bad River and Red Cliff together actually asked the Park Service to consider designating their lands as a big part of the park, which was unheard of, because the Park Service, the Native Americans are no friends of the Park Service because of repeated histories of dislocation. But in this case, the tribes were in the middle of a real battle with the state of Wisconsin over treaty rights, and they wanted the federal government to help them in their battle against the state of Wisconsin. The federal government said, well, we love your land, but we're not willing to step into this battle between you and the state. That's up to you guys. Then the tribes pulled their support and pulled their lands out of the park. The initial park proposal included big chunks of the Red Cliff Reservation and the Bad River Reservation. So it could have been a very different park in that regard.
So what's your interpretation of pristine?
I can use air quotes every time I say it. I don't think there really is such a place anymore. You know, climate change is pretty much everywhere. I'm not sure that it's a useful word. I actually think the word healthy is a better word. If we're thinking about a pristine place that humans have never touched, that doesn't really mean anything, because how far back do you have to go to find a time when there were no humans? As I said, Native American inhabitants throughout North America really profoundly shaped North America. You know, there's more trees in the United States today. More of the United States is covered by forest today than it was in 1492. And that has to do with the fact that we like trees in our suburbs, and Native Americans burned lands everywhere for agriculture and for hunting and for travel and all sorts of other reasons. So when you're getting into the weeds, if you will, of this stuff, thinking about whether a place is healthy or not is sometimes a better guide. Is that a good punt?
Good enough.
Well, I think this has been terrific. You guys have been great.
Really a pleasure
joining
us here. So.
Yeah, really in the show.
We've got a lot of questions.
Yeah, that was great. Thank you very much. And you can find me easily enough if you want to follow the conversation. Thanks, everybody.